Today we're going to be talking over to PM Sloot. PM is based in the Netherlands. He's an artist, activist, and a wizard in his own right. And you will know why once you check out his profile on Instagram. So definitely go check it out. PM, yes. So I wanted to start with the first question, which is tell us about yourself. What do you do or love doing? We'd love to know about your journey, how you started, and how you've evolved into the work, you know, that you do now.
Yeah, thanks. First of all, thanks for inviting. Yeah, I was born in the Netherlands. When I was 4 years old, my parents, they emigrated to Latin America. So I lived, I grew up in Argentina and in Chile. And in 2001, we moved back to the Netherlands. And I studied here in Utrecht on the Art Academy, studied and graduated as a graphic designer in 2010. After that, I worked as a designer for around 4 or 5 years. Together with a good friend of mine, we worked a lot for the cultural sector, and we had our studio in Amsterdam. So a lot for the theater, for festivals, for music clients. And now I think it's five years ago, more or less, we decided to stop our company, and I started to focus more on my autonomous projects more a visual artist. But I have a background in graphic design, so you see that a lot also in my work.
Yes.
And I still also work sometimes as a designer. But yeah, mostly more on my autonomous projects.
Okay.
That's kind of like summed up. Yeah.
Of course. So do you work with brands also, like as a freelancer?
What I did when I stopped my graphic design company, I was very radical. And then I said, okay, I'm not going to design anymore. I'm just going to make art. And that change was very, took place in 1 year. It was 2015, I think. And then in that year, I really developed my own style as an artist, which is based in graphic shapes and dots and very bright colors.
Yeah.
Based on that style, I got brands or clients that were like, "Hey, we really love what you make. Can we use that as a pattern on shirts or as the album cover for LP of a band and stuff like that?"
Yeah.
And then kind of like I let go of this idea of like I'm not gonna design anymore, because I really enjoy if people use my art in many different directions. You can use it.
Yep, you can, because I've also seen like if you've also used it as street art or like as album cover, like you said. So it's definitely something that can go places for sure.
Yeah.
So bring us to the second one, which is how are you dealing with the current scenario? Is your work affected? Any personal projects you've been up to during this lockdown period?
Yeah, it was a very interesting process the past two and a half months. When in the Netherlands, the outbreak of the corona happened, I took it very seriously, and I moved all the materials and the things I used to make my art. I moved it all in my to my house, and I kind of like create my own studio there. And in this quarantine, I don't know how you pronounce it exactly in English. My artistic practice kind of like exploded, because I had a lot of inputs. We got a lot of negative news, and I was able to deal with the negativity in a really productive way. So my anxiety, my anger, or my frustration with things, I really translated it directly into visual things.
Yeah.
So I was sharing a lot on my social media, and I was going out at nights to do graffiti in the streets with messages I thought was important to share.
I saw some of those, yes.
Yeah. And for me, it was a very productive time. One of the first things I did was I wrote a manifesto, which is called the Art Manifesto of Solidarity. And it was about how we as artists or designers or musicians or whatever, you know, like I see artists in a very general way. How can we react to the crisis that's happening worldwide?
Yeah.
And for me, that was, I started with the manifesto. Then I started designing posters again, like with my graphic background, together with a collective with friends here in Amsterdam. We did the posters. You could download for free. People could print them out. I started making memes for the internet, like funny images. And I started making the graffiti in the streets, podcasts. And of course, art, which is very important. Like I worked with the stickers.
This is the red.
The sold stickers. When in an art gallery, artwork is sold. You put on the right, you put the red sticker, so people know this artwork has been sold. And this you have in like many sizes and shapes and colors.
Okay.
And I make this optical illusions with it.
Yeah.
And what's very important to know about my art is that how I sell my art is also very important process and part of the work. And because the material, it all already refers to selling art.
Yeah.
What I try to do in that is try to challenge the capitalism in the art.
Yeah.
I talk for hours about that, but let's keep it short. Yeah. Maybe.
No, that brings me to one of your interesting projects, which I love, the Art Dollar. So that I checked out, and it's like it's so bang on. It's like amazing. Do you want to talk about it a little? Like what inside start that idea?
Yeah, that's one of the nice projects I did in this period of COVID. And what I think is the solution to the problems we are facing as humanity at this moment is that we are the economies are like so global and so big. And this project called the Art Dollar, it's from the song from the Wu-Tang Clan, you know, like dollar, dollar, bill, yeah. it was inspired of in a community in Mexico, in Jajalpa. And it's a little town in Mexico where what they did was they printed their own currency, and it's called the Jajal Peso. And what what they did with this was try to encourage to people to buy local products. So you could use this new currency that the municipality was printing it and giving them out, only to buy vegetables and fruits from local farmers. And then I think the solution to a lot of the problems is that we have to start to live more locally. I came up with this new currency for Amsterdam, for the city of Amsterdam, and it's called, as I said, the Art Dollar.
Yeah, yeah.
And the concept behind it is that you can buy this, I printed it, this new bills, you can buy them with me. With that new currency, you can buy an artwork from any artist in the city of Amsterdam. And what happens is that when you pay with that bill, for the artwork, you get the work, and then the artist, he has to come to me to change this bill for euros. And we try to create like a support kind of like economy for the arts in Amsterdam. That's the first step of it. And the second one is that it's very direct. So there is no galleries, there's no agents, there's nothing. I am like a bank. I'm an artist, and I will function as a bank.
As a bank, yes. Yeah.
Yeah. You give me the euros, I give you the art dollars, you buy an artwork with it, and then that artist has to come to my studio to exchange for dollars. And the idea is that I will then talk with the artist about, what is this whole, what is capital doing to the arts? Then we engage in a conversation in which I can tell them my opinion and they can share theirs. And at the same time, like imagine you are somebody that has a lot of money. You can buy this art dollars, and then you can give them around to people
that
maybe don't have so much money to actually buy art. So it's also like a way on dividing the wealth.
That's right. It works both ways. I think it's a brilliant idea. I think it should definitely be taken to like someone should use it in other countries as well. Like I'm sure it should inspire others to create something out of it. So.
I think everybody could. I already got some propositions from other cities in the Netherlands, but it will be amazing if like every community kind of like starts their own. Because, you know, in Mexico, in Jajalpa, you know, they also just started with it. And now we have the Amsterdam Art Dollar, and it will be great to have in each city. You know? These new currencies that are, they try to reshape the economy. That's what's interesting about it. Because there's nothing wrong with money. It's just the way how it's used in the economy. That's the problem.
That's the problem, yes. What are your plans when things get back to normal, however long it may take?
Yeah, I kind of like, I have this, one of my points in the manifesto is like, we are not going back to normal. So I kind of like decided that for myself personally, like, I think this, the shock waves, how do you call it? It's a Dutch expression, maybe, like, so you have the peak, the whole crisis, and then everything that comes behind, it's going to take like years to recover from that. And I think I see a role for artists and designers to reshape the way we live in this period.
Yeah.
So that's a little bit where I'm aiming to work.
Yeah, it's going to have long lasting impacts, like, for sure. Like, just like the other periods where in history where you have seen big, large changes happen throughout, and they've lasted like for decades, and, you know, that's what it's going to be. So.
Yeah, exactly. The COVID was a start, and there are many, many other challenges coming ahead, climate change. And scientists are saying these pandemics are going to happen more often. So, yeah, it's like, this was kind of like a wake up call in a way, for me at least.
And has it changed something in terms of your process of working or how you approached things before and now you, how you do that now?
Yeah, but what has been a really big inspiration for me in this 2 months has been the books of Tolkien, The Lord of the Rings. And I have a fascination with those books since I was a little kid. And then the movies came when I was a teenager. So I was a very big fan also of that. And it's been in my life for a very long time. And when the crisis happened, I saw a lot of parallels on how Tolkien writes about this fight between good and bad. And I kind of like dived into that. And it was a beautiful way out for me to deal with the situation. So it was very personal because I know the books by heart and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And at the same time, I identified myself a lot with the character of Gandalf, you know, this old wizard.
Yeah.
Because what the wizard does is, that's why I'm like artist, activist, and a wizard now. This is something new since this COVID-19 crisis.
Yeah.
It's because I started to create this, or to inform a lot and to create this awareness of what's happening. And that's what the wizard does a lot.
Yeah.
But at the same time, the wizard has a very relaxed lifestyle. And he would love to be with the hobbits and, you know, just smoke his pipe and enjoy the nature, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he has this very relaxed way of life. But at the same time, when he sees a crisis, he takes action. There are many characters that I took into my own personal life, but also the way I work.
Yeah.
So I try to be a bit more relaxed about things, and things will happen when they need to happen. And
for sure.
A lot of things got canceled for me also, exhibitions. And, you know, my future is also very uncertain.
Yeah.
But I just try to accept the situation and work with it.
I was just coming to that, like, what does the future hold for you? Because I'm sure it's, as a definition, future has changed for all of us, like in the last couple of months. So what does that hold for you? Do you have any personal projects coming up? Do you have any exhibitions? Are there any plans for, like, doing other projects like the Art Dollar or the Manifesto? Oh,
yeah.
Sorry.
I had a couple of exhibitions planned for this year in the Netherlands. Some have been postponed, I kind of like see a balance in between the digital developments that are happening. Now I move my practice like really in the digital medium, you know, social media and all this kind of like online things play a very important role in my practice. And now, but now that things are opening a little bit more, then also I get asked again for like exhibitions and things like that.
Yeah.
So it's going to be like a balance in between those two things. What has made very clear this crisis to me is that my practice is going to be more radical than it actually already was. And it was already quite radical, you know, like how I sell my artworks and how I produce them and what kind of exhibitions I do, etc.
Yeah,
it's going to get more radical and like more projects like the Art Dollar are coming up.
Nice.
I have a whole new, how do you call it? A big project called The Fellowship, which is about this, the whole inspiration on the Tolkien's. And I have like my sketchbook, like it's full of new ideas
full
and
of ideas.
New
I'm
artworks.
Sure.
And it's exciting times ahead.
Yep.
And so it's very uncertain, but also very challenging and exciting. So
yeah,
I'm
yeah.
looking forward to it. Yeah.
Great. What do you do when you're like absolutely not doing anything? Like, I'm sure there are moments when you're like just, you know, completely free of anything or any thought or anything. What is that one thing that you love doing at that time?
Yeah, very nice question. I think doing nothing is like super important thing because most of my ideas and most of my concept, they either come from doing nothing or they come from making the process of making. So when I do nothing, I'm really relaxed. And you notice, you know, like when you get bored, you know, and a lot of people go to their phone, you know, all day and then
they
cannot be bored anymore. I totally recommend to just sit outside and do nothing because, it's amazing. And what I do when I do nothing is sit in my garden at home with my cat and just enjoy the sun, listening to music, drink the mate, you know, it's this Argentinian drinks, and just be a little bit just with yourself. And
That I think is the best time for like just receiving all these ideas and thoughts and everything as just kind of receiving and receiving and receiving, and that just kind of
the
best time for that.
Yeah, definitely. And I two things. But I also really like to see that also a lot of things are happening at the same time. So the zeitgeist, right? So when people allowed just to have nothing and let the ideas come, you see that it happened. The same ideas come to all places around the world. It's beautiful to see, especially in a time of crisis. I see a lot of similar projects appearing and people connecting and talking about the same subjects.
Yeah.
And another thing, when you ask what do when you do nothing, I love to play chess. It is doing something, but chess for me is very nice way also to only have your mind focused on one little thing.
Yeah.
And I play it online with friends, but also physically.
Great. Are you good at it?
Sorry? Yeah, I don't know. Some friends are very better than me.
Okay.
And I lose many times, but I enjoy also the game, you know, that sometimes
the strategy and
depends how I lose, you know, like some games I lose and then I'm pissed off, like I made so many mistakes.
Yeah.
And sometimes I lose because my opponent did such an amazing things, and then I'm like beautiful, you know, and then I'm not angry at all. Yeah.
Amazing. Any advice you would give to your 18-year-old self, which also means anyone at that age, essentially, that aims to walk along the path you chose for yourself?
Yeah, to 18-year-old. Yeah, one thing I learned also in this period, and I learned that in the past years from the punk community in Amsterdam, like punk music and a bit more the anarchistic way of thinking of a certain community in Amsterdam where I'm also part of. And what is very important there is that usually we associate things like fear and anger and anxiety with they are negative forces, right?
Yeah.
But for example, in punk music, it's very aggressive. And when you dance to it, it's like very aggressive. But at the same time, it's very solidaire, you know, like if you are in a punk concert and one person falls down, everybody stops and they help you to pick up. So there is this certain combination of this anger with something very constructive. And I noticed that in the with the crisis outbreak, is that you can, if you feel anxious or like scared or like all these kind of emotions that we experienced, channel them into something constructive. Because usually when you get anxious, you stop doing things.
Yeah.
What I saw a lot is like, I use it to actually to create, you know, so these frustrations, I was like, oh yeah, I'm gonna fucking do something about it.
Yeah.
That change in you personally, that's like a filter from negativity into something more maybe positive or more constructive or funny, or you know, like each of us are like this filter of negative things into constructive things. And especially artists and creative people are very good at dealing with this.
And in times like these, those things actually grow manifold. I mean, they become exponentially like, you know, increased in terms of their effect and everything. So,
yeah, exactly. Just maybe a little thing you do, then the effect can become really big in the near future.
Great. Yeah. Thanks a lot for this short talk and coming on board on such a short notice. Loved hearing all the ideas, and I actually look forward to all the new ideas that come out of this period and the new things that you'll be doing this year or the next following months. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, thank you very much. And stay tuned. And I also follow all you guys from the design company, and amazing what you're doing. And very nice to have this connection also. It went through through this open collabor in Germany with them. And great connections, you know, worldwide.
Thanks a lot. We'd love to collaborate on something soon. So hopefully we should stay in touch and
most definitely.
All right. Thank you. Thanks a lot. See you. Bye.
Ciao.